need to see it. All right, that's good. Anytime, Mayor.
All right.
And this is your camera. Gotcha. This one's yours.
Well, let's see. Let me see if I can get in his.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
I don't need one.
All right. Hello, I'm Bob Matheny, Mayor of Zebulon, and this is the Zebulon Mayor Show. Today we're going to talk about the budget, which was, you know, it was a pretty tough year for the budget. Last couple of years have been, but joining me is Bobby Fitz, who is our finance director, and glad to have you here. Appreciate it. Mm-hmm. We're going to run through the budget and try to familiarize you. We obviously can't hit every line item, but we can give you a sense of what we've done. And as I said, it was a very tenuous year to get this budget done, and I don't think anybody would agree with me more than this man sitting here. Zebulon has really suffered through the loss of the whole harmless funds. You know, the census numbers hurt us, and then also, since we are so strong industrially, commercially, a lot of those facilities were not replenishing or buying new equipment, and so depreciation was coming in fairly strong on those. The good news is, I think we're turning around.
Exactly.
We're seeing a lot of things happening now. Four of our five subdivisions are building. The fifth subdivision is looking at gearing up, and then we also have commercial interest building as well. So there is hope on the horizon.
There is.
Now, down to business, let's talk about this year's budget and just talk about some of the highlights, Bob, if you will, and okay. We'll just move through.
All right. As you said, it has been a tough couple of years, but we do kind of see some light at the end of the tunnel, hopefully. As always, the goal of staff and the Board of Commissioners is to prepare a budget that minimizes or eliminates the tax increase and is retains our strong fund balance that we currently have and have had for a while now, while still providing the same citizen services the citizens have been accustomed to and appreciate. So we think we did that. We did not have a tax increase. It remains at 52.5 cents per 100 valuation. The total budget, including funds rolled over from past year, is 8.4 million roughly. That includes rolled over funds, as I said, completing the UDO, Shepherd School Road sidewalks. So we did have one general fund increase, and that's the vehicle tax fee. We went from $5 to $10 on that per vehicle. As you said, we do have some, as always, we have depreciation on business, personal property. But as we said, the future is bright. We have some about $13 million in real property growth this year. So that's good, and we feel that's gonna continue in the coming years.
Well, let's explain two things very briefly. One, explain rollover. Mm-hmm. And two, we need to tell them that UDO is Unified Development Ordinance.
Right.
I mean, we get used to that.
Right.
So.
Yeah, the funds that were rolled over, these were budgeted items from last year that were not completed. The UDO, or the Unified Development Ordinance, which we started last fiscal year, is something that hadn't been updated. I think it was about 30 years or so. That's about an 18-month process. We got about halfway through, roughly, last year. So the rest of those funds were rolled over to this year. And then, like, the Shepherd School Road, which was budgeted last year, didn't happen. We rolled those over to this current year as well.
Okay, I just want to be sure that everybody understands what we're talking about. We're used to the terminology, and they may not be. Some of them are, I'm sure, but some are not. Well, let's look at some of the things that happened internally in the budget.
Okay. Some other highlights of the budget: we did appropriate about $863,000 in fund balance. That large amount due to, as you mentioned, the Hold Harmless funds, where last year it was up for debate when we adopted the budget, but then we ended up getting about a half share, about $220,000. That was eliminated completely in this budget. So that's $400,000 hit, or, you know, compared to last year, about $200,000. So that's a big chunk.
Significant for us.
It is. It's, you know, 5 cents on the tax rate, essentially. We did include funding, continuing funding on the bus service, the Wendell, Zeb and Wendell Express that runs to Raleigh at $15,000. This is the last year of the JARC grant, funding a portion of that. As I mentioned, the Shepherd School Road project is budgeted to for this year.
And let me stop you right there for a minute. Update on that is that the bids came in. This has just been an ongoing saga. I refer to it in the meeting as a snake bit project, and it seems like it is, because every time we think we've got it under control, we find we don't. It came in $72,000 over budget when we opened the bid, so we're back exactly financially where we were about a year ago. We went back and thought we fixed it. We got more grant money. We did this, we did that. We rebid the project, and here we are again. So while it's budgeted, we don't know what's going to happen to our project yet. So I wanted to give everybody an update on that one. Okay.
All right. As far as water and sewer goes, there was a 5.5% rate increase on that as the pro forma, the merger agreement with Raleigh states. And also, there's a new infrastructure renewal fee that the city of Raleigh is charging effective July 1. That amounts to about $3.25 per month, in addition to the 5.5% rate increase. That's on a residential 5/8 inch meter, and it's got a growth factor on that as far as the larger meters. It's more than $3.25 a month.
Right.
Some good news, our Wake County fire tax revenue, the county did approve a expansion request that we submitted for the safer grant positions that the funding ran out for in 2013. Well, the grant expired, I should say. So they will cover the cost of those, which is good.
Right. Let me go back on the infrastructure renewal fee and just explain briefly what that is. Basically, it's been determined that there's not been any money set aside to repair and upgrade aging water and sewer lines. So the city of Raleigh evaluated it and decided that X amount of dollars, and I can't remember exactly what it was, $50 million a year, I think, but I'm not sure, and it's really irrelevant, needed to be raised to go in and repair and upgrade the aging lines under the ground. And right. That's what the infrastructure renewal fee is trying to do, right. Is establish a fund for that, and decided to do it that way rather than just build it into the rate structure itself. So it's probably, for the homeowner, a little cheaper way to go, I would guess. But that I just want to be sure that everybody understands, right. You know, what that is. Well, let's talk about personnel for a minute.
Okay. We pretty much just stuck with the same as last year, except for we added one position in public works. We used part-time money last year. We just had a couple part-time employees in public works that kind of just bridged the gap. We lost two positions the prior year. We did add one position back, but eliminated all the part-time positions that were in there last year. And so we went from 58 to 59 full-time positions for this year. Total salaries for those 59 positions is just over $3 million.
Okay, and you had mentioned some of that. The Parks and Recreation had one reclassification.
Right, there was one position in Parks and Recreation that will be reclassified effective January 1.
Right, and then any vacancies that come up are going to be scrutinized and reviewed before they're filled.
Correct.
And, so the point of that is we're keeping our fingers on the pulse so that it doesn't get away from us.
Exactly.
We were able to come up with a little bit of money for raises, not a lot, but let's talk about that.
Okay. As we've done the last couple of years, we've we've always only done merit. Some places do cost of living adjustments. Since I've been here, we've, I don't believe, ever done that I recall.
No, it's been a long time.
But we did do the same as last year, a 1.5% maximum merit based on annual review. That equates, if everybody was to get the 1.5, it would equate to about $55,000, including FICA and retirement. And then we budgeted for a possible 10% increase in health and dental insurance, which is renewable at January 1st. We'll do that on the calendar year.
Right. Health insurance has, rates have been rather tumultuous, so I hope 10% is enough.
Yeah.
No, we all do.
Yeah.
Well, we did not do away with capital projects. We did away with some that were proposed, so let's talk about that for a minute.
Yeah, we did eliminate some that was planned originally, totaling about $355,000. We had some scheduled street paving, an amount of roughly about $200,000. That's kind of what we schedule, if you want to call it that, every other year. So that was pushed off. A data server, a fire vehicle that was pushed back another year, maybe two. And then at the fire station, a GIS computer and a HVAC replacement was also delayed. And then finally, a ramjet that was planned to be split between streets and stormwater has been delayed as well.
Okay. Now, let's explain, like the fire GIS computer, basically that's a locator.
Right.
That you put in the address and it tells you how to get there, kind of like your Garmin's and that sort of thing. And then, of course, the HVAC, I think everybody knows what that is. And ramjet is simply a high-pressure water to blow through and clean sewer lines and storm drains, I think. So we'll be sure everybody understands what we're talking about. Again, some do and some don't, so I want to explain that. There were some projects that made the cut, though.
Right.
So let's talk about that.
There were some. As we mentioned, the Shepherd School Road sidewalks is budgeted to be completed. As the mayor said, that's still a little bit up in the air. Hopefully it can. We're working on all avenues that can maybe work for us. But that's budgeted. And then another sidewalk project, which we will find out in January, whether we get the Safe Routes to School grant.
So, as
the Shepherd School Road sidewalk is also mainly funded through grants, a good portion of it, as well as the way of the street. Then the North Arundel Avenue improvements was going to be started this year, and that's using transportation impact fees. Those are new fees collected starting in this past April. That'll go towards that, as well some of those will be going to the Yates Place stormwater improvement project, phase one of that project. And right now we have street repair, basically patching, just miscellaneous repair of about $75,000, budgeted.
Well, on the North Arundel, we're looking at this. Gets us on it. No way does $85,000 cover the thing. It's about a $5 million project and would be done in cooperation with DOT.
Right.
Phase one goes from basically the 64 overpass up to just past Bojangles. So that's what the area that we're looking at now, and that general intersection at Pierce's Road, that sort of thing. Yates Place, some people might not be familiar to that. You get to Yates Place by going through Wedgwood, behind the shopping center of that subdivision, and it's on the western side, and water is, in a rainstorm, is piling up and flooding down in the lower section just simply because the drain lines, the storm drains, are not large enough to carry the water out. So that's what we're talking about doing in Yates Place. There's actually, that's a two-phase project. If phase one is enough, we'll stop there. If it's not, we'll go back and revisit it and do phase two. But phase one is going to open it up, put in larger drains, and put in a retention pond. And so, you know, it's just some work that needs to be done. So anyway, I want to be sure people understand. Well, there are a few other capital projects as well.
Right. There is the another is the town hall basement improvements. It was recently last year discovered there's a moisture problem down there. What they're going to do is do some work to eliminate that. They got a vapor barrier, some other things, totaling about $65,000. That will be funded through our capital reserve fund. They're also funded through capital reserve is the fuel tank shed that will go over the fuel tanks down our public works facility, which will, they've been having a lot of problems with condensation, the heat causing condensation in the tanks, and the water mixed in with the fuel is causing a lot of problems. So this fuel tank shed, basically like a, you know, just a carport type thing, if you want to look at it that way, to hopefully eliminate the condensation problem. Then also there's mowing equipment and totaling $26,000. Basically that'll get about two mowers. And then two public works truck body replacements totaling about $10,800. And then as we mentioned before, the completion of the unified development ordinance is started this past year.
Well, you know, there's some things that we've done to help save money in day-to-day and month-to-month operations. So let's talk about that.
Okay. Yeah, the years past, we've kind of almost trimmed the operating budget as much as we could, essentially. But we did find a couple other things we could possibly do this year. So we the travel and training budgets were trimmed across all departments. We didn't make sure to maintain certifications and all mandatory safety trainings, things like that. But we did cut about $17,600 compared to last year, which is tough. Everybody had to kind of buckle down and, you know.
And this might sound like nickels and dimes, but nickel and dimes make dollars, and that's, you know, and that's just what we're doing, is looking in every nook and cranny for the savings that we can come up with. But there's some other things that we did consider.
Yeah, we, as I think we considered last year as well, possibly eliminating the bus service. We got data from TTA, Triangle Transit, as far as ridership, and just kind of really tried to gauge, was it worth it? Were people using it? And, you know, we kind of decided that we did want to keep doing it this year, at least for the first half of the year. As I mentioned, the JARC grant runs out this fiscal year. We do need to give them 6 month notice if we decided to, and if we did want to end the partnership with them. But that could have resulted in about $15,000 savings. But at this time, we just decided to go ahead with it. So that's, like I said, that next year that'll be on the table again.
Yeah, it'll be looked at very closely again next year. And I don't think anybody really wants to do away with the bus service, but losing the JARC grant would basically double what we're having to put in. And so then you have to look at the equity numbers there and say it's worth it. I don't think anybody wants to cut the bus service. We'd like to remain connected to the rest of Wake County.
Right.
But we have to look at everything.
Right. You know, exactly.
So, what I like to call philanthropic money, let's talk, explain that.
We do each year fund some nonprofit groups that go through the application process, which starts in January, where applications sent to them or they request one. It's due back in February. Our policy allows for a maximum of $5,000 per year to these nonprofit groups, but no more than $1,000 to any one group. This year we had 9 applicants that requested $27,000. This year we decided to go with the same as last year. The Chamber of Commerce getting $1,000, East Wake Education Foundation getting $1,000. Shepherd's Care Medical Clinic getting $1,000, and the Martin Luther King Jr. Breakfast Committee received $500.
Yeah, the board established this 5,000 cap and 1,000 per organization some years ago, and I personally believe it's worked very well, because we were getting such a tremendous amount of requests, and as you said, 27,000 just this year. But it used to be a lot worse than that. So in any event, we're being very very cautious and conservative with those donations, and but every year they're on the table. Mm-hmm. We have to look at them every year. Well, you know, back several years ago, we merged with the city of Raleigh with our utilities, water and sewer, and they're known as enterprise funds, which means that their revenues support them. They should not be subsidized with general revenue tax dollars. So let's explain what's going on there.
Okay. As you said, our merger agreement calls for rate increases each year. So this year, again, it was a 5.5% rate increase. And as I mentioned, the new infrastructure renewal fee on there as well. The increase in the renewal fee equates to about an $8.81 per month increase for average customer, which we call average customer about a 5,000 gallon a month user. And then as well, the capacity fees are going up 3% again, per the merger agreement. Those are fees that are charged to development, you know, new homes being built, et cetera, commercial, whatever. And you'll see the chart there, and it shows the old and the new rates for the admin rates for water and sewer and the per 1,000 gallon charge.
Well, the next sheet we're going to look at sort of explains the projection of the enterprise fund. Right now, our water and sewer rates are, the rough numbers, twice what the city of Raleigh's is. That's because we're paying off debt that we had when we merged with Raleigh, and some new projects. Infrastructure work, new projects. But once that debt is paid, then our rates will be the same as Raleigh. So explain where we're headed on that and what this chart is telling us.
Okay, this chart shows basically where the payoff is, which we have till 2024 to meet the payout. this chart shows, the red line shows where the revenues meet the capital outlays and expenditures. So what that shows is basically right now we're on time to meet the payout in July 1, 2024. That's kind of a confusing picture, but essentially what you're looking at is, you know, where that red line meets the other line there.
Where they cross at the top on the right side, that's the payout.
That's when, you know, that's when revenues surpass
right. And we're about 10 years out on that, unfortunately. The good news is it's not more than 10 years, I guess, if you want to look at it that way. But nonetheless, it's the merger was something that basically was necessary with all the new criteria that had to be met for water and sewer service. Well, let's do a recap of the system impact, Bob, and explain to people what's happened here.
Okay. As I said before, there were no general fund increases other than the vehicle tag fee increase that went from 5 to 10. The garbage rate, stormwater, those remain the same as last year, and no property tax rate increase. So in the long run, the annual increase for a citizen was about $113 a year, or about $943 per month. And the majority of that's water and sewer fees. As I said, the vehicle tag fee, average home has about 1.5 cars, so that would equate to about a $7.50 increase there. But the water and sewer rates are the big increase there.
I understand. Well, as we stated at the beginning, it's been a tough year.
and last year was. Next year is not going to be particularly easy either. Our goal is to quit deficit funding. Yeah, right now we're having to go into our fund balance, which is our savings account, basically, to balance the budget. Growth, as it comes along, we think will solve that problem, and that's our goal, is to get back in a positive direction. But it's not been easy, but that's why we have a rainy day fund. It sure has been raining.
A lot.
Okay. Well, Bob, I appreciate your time with this, and
no problem.
I will say that if anyone has any questions, they're free to give you a call.
Right.
Give me a call. If I know the answer, I'll give it to you. If I don't, I won't come to you, because you're the person we rely on to put all this together. So having said that, I hope this information has been useful to you. See you next month.